Welcome back to The Breakfast on Plus TV Africa. We head straight to our second conversation where you have Nigerians Union. Some group are saying that Nigerians Union is ripe for negotiation. And to make sense of all of this, we will be speaking with Mark Adeboye, who is a public affairs analyst. I beg your pardon, Mark Adebayo, a public affairs analyst. All right, good morning, Mark Adeboye. It's good to have you join us.
Yeah, good morning. Good morning, my sister. Compliments of the session.
Okay, so let's talk about this. You have, the group who have actually come out to say, yes, it's time for us to have that renegotiation. Let's have the, conversation as to allowing some persons, because we also want to agree with me that there's a constitutional review that's going on. Now, the argument here is that you need to suspend the constitutional review and a call for, a referendum for those who are agitating for self-determination, to go their way. So we understand who we have in Nigeria. More like, let's understand what's happening. Let's understand who is left. This is what, you have this group of persons saying.
Thank you so much. Good morning once again.
Good morning.
Can you hear me?
Yes, we can hear you. Go ahead.
Okay. I think this conversation is long overdue. The biggest lies, that we have been telling one another in this country for a very long time is that the unity of Nigeria is non-negotiable. All that is balderdash. The unity of a country cannot be based on injustice, and we expect that unity to survive. It cannot. So Nigeria has been long overdue for renegotiation, for a rediscussion and a rediscovery, for us to move forward as a country, because Nigeria is not actually a nation, we are just a country, because of our differences, which have been exacerbated in the last 6 years plus of the Buhari administration. We have never been this divided. We have never been this ethno-religiously conscious. So Nigeria has been long overdue for renegotiation. So like I said at the beginning, the biggest lie we have told ourselves in this country is the fact that Nigeria's unity or union is non-negotiable. Nothing can be further from the truth. You cannot say for the sake of family solidarity for you to remain in an abusive marriage, for instance. If somebody says marriage is indissoluble, but you are in a violent marriage, you are in an abusive marriage, your life is more important than marriage. That you are alive is more precious than remaining in a marriage. And many people are foolishly remaining in a violent marriage that eventually cost them their lives. So we cannot have a country where the falcon cannot hear the falconer. And you expect us to remain without discussing the basis upon which we are going to proceed as a country. We need to give opportunity to people who have divergent views about the continuous existence of Nigeria as a corporate entity. We need to allow them to give expression to their views through referendum, which has been long overdue. Some of us, at the level of Core Federalists, an organization to which I belong, we were advocating for restructuring the country. But it's like that one is already late in the day, because while we were advocating for restructuring, the powers that be wouldn't want to hear about that. Now there are people who have come up who are self-determinationists who say, look, we are even tired of the whole concept of Nigeria. We want everybody, all Israel, to his house. So I believe very strongly too that every sincere Nigerian know that this country is long overdue for renegotiation. We need to rediscuss Nigeria. We need to come to the table and discuss the basis upon which we want to continue to live together as a corporate entity. So if we allow that to happen, for instance, we allow for a referendum, for people to even determine first and foremost whether they want to continue to remain within a corporate Nigeria. We need to determine that. Whether the North wants to continue, whether the South Southeast want to continue, or South-South, or Southwest, North-Central, Northwest, Northeast. So we need for us to come together at a round table to discuss whether we want to continue as a corporate entity, and upon what basis are we continuing. And if you are not going to continue, if some people feel strongly about opting out, it's a constitutional and international right. There are international legal instruments that allow for that. And we should not silence people who believe that Nigeria should be renegotiated. And of course, for people to now determine the basis upon which we will continue to live together.
All right, Mr. Adebayo. But let's look at Nigeria historically and talk of, when it comes to the Nations Union, all the roundtables and discussions that, have been held. You know, the CNG is saying that, let's do a referendum. Let's those calling for self-determination, actually know if that would actually work. But if I were to ask you, do you really think that if Nigerians were to get what they want, as in the secessionist, those with the secessionist theory get what they want, do you think the country would be better off for it, judging by the fact that some people ordinarily cannot even generate their own income internally?
Well, you see, it is not even about whether some entities are viable or not. It is for us to discover or to discuss what really led to this call. What led to this call? It is primarily and fundamentally caused by leadership failure. Leadership failure. This Nigeria would have been a great country. I believe we are better together. I think we are greater together. But when you begin to see nepotism, the barefaced, almost criminal manner, whereby some people now begin to feel like fifth class citizens in their own country, where if you are not from a particular part of the country, if you are not from a particular religion, you are not considered a Nigerian for instance, some of us now believe that the fularization agenda is real. The Buhari administration has not helped matters. Nobody has come with this agitationist and self-determinationist issues pre-Buhari. When it was during the June 12, we, the Yoruba people, felt justifiably hurt and unjustly dealt with when the June 12 election was annulled, and the identity of that June 12 election was murdered. So we got angry and said, okay, we began to have do our self-determination groups, we began to have Yoruba Nation groups. That was June. But after the June 12 issues, went down, and of course the country had to move on. Nobody was talking about that again. But immediately Buhari came in. Buhari exacerbated our ethno-religious diversities. Rather than, the kind of diversity we have is something that would have made another country great if we were to have the right leadership. So it is failure of leadership. If there were justice, nobody would be demanding for referendum. In fact, nobody will be demanding for restructuring. Nobody will be demanding for self-determination. Nobody will be asking for a renegotiation of Nigeria. Nigeria, the largest black country in the world, will have been better together. But for the fact that it is being rubbed on our faces that if you are not a Fulani, if you are not a Northerner, you are like second class or third class citizen in this country. Because the Buhari administration has failed to manage our diversity in a manner that will give confidence and hope to all Nigerians that, yes, we can continue as a country. The demand for self-determination, the demand for renegotiation of Nigeria is on the basis of the injustices, aggravated injustices, as promoted by the Buhari administration. Let me give you one instance. The issue of killer adders. Adders that move about killing people in their farms, in their towns, and now they have graduated to become bandits and become terrorists. And then each of the states, especially in the South, say, look, even in the North, are saying that, look, we cannot have people under the guise of herding cattle, committing such heinous criminal activities. We are going to have state security agencies to be able to deal with that, because the police refuse to anything. If you go to the police station and report anything about killer riders, nobody's going to. They won't attend to you. They won't attend to you. I do not know. That is why in one of my interviews I said that, like, an organization like Mietiala and all these cattle herders are privileged terrorists under the Buhari administration, because you cannot touch them. The security agency will not touch them. If cows invade your farm, or if invade your environment or your community, like it happened in the Edo State, where cattle were sent into a primary school and they went into a classroom and the pupils had to run and leave their classes. That is the kind of impunity that these killer herders have under the Buhari administration. That is why you see that the Buhari administration has refused to agree that there should be an ranching of cattle rather than having a free roaming of animals. Each time, any issue, the only issue that this administration is emotional about, is passionate about, is when it comes to the issue of killer herders. We would say we don't want free roaming of animals, they will come up and say, no, you cannot disturb people's businesses. If you say we want ranching, that everybody should go and ranch their cattle, the federal government, through Garba Shehu or through Femi Adesina, will come up against Nigerians that are asking for that. Why? Because they want to give privilege to some people who are from some part of the country. And that is, even if that is not what they are doing, if that is not what they are doing, if that is not their intention, that is the impression they are creating for all of us. Immediately, you know, the issue of these killer herders got out of hand. That was when you discovered that was when the issue of the self-determination and agitation for the country to be dismembered became rife. Because the government has continued to support these killer herders. You remember that 4 or 5 years ago, the federal government offered Mietiala 100 billion naira just so that there will not be violent, they will not be killing people. They offer. I'm sure you remember that happened in this country. That was a negotiation. And those ones said, no, we want a minimum of 200 billion. So they know that these guys are violent characters. But the government, rather than deal with them, they decided to bribe them. But some of us rose up in our voices and began to shout, no, that's not going to happen. Why should you do that? Cattle rearing is a private business. It is not something that the federal government will now begin to. You remember what Femi Adesina said? Either you give your land, you give your life. So the choice is yours. How can, there is no responsible government in the world that will say that? So that is why I said, let us talk about the causes of these agitations. You know, the causes. Number one cause is failure of leadership. Failure of leadership. The inability or the unwillingness to manage our diversity in a way that will please everybody. That is the cause of these things. Nobody wanted Nigeria to be dismembered. Nobody wanted Nigeria to disunite. But when you have a leadership that is unable to guarantee justice, that is unable to guarantee equity, that is unable to guarantee even progress and development in the country, people want to say, look, well, I think I'm better off to be on my own part of the country. I think that is the issue. We have to fix our leadership issue. We have to fix our leadership question. It is the leadership question that is raising the Nigerian question, and we have to answer those two.
Okay, let's also look at some of the concerns that some persons have raised over time. I mean, the issue or the fact that Nigeria is an illegal entity in the sense that the Treaty of Amalgamation of 1914, that brought Nigeria together has expired. And so we're looking at, in 2014, that Nigeria right now is an illegal entity. And some quarters are saying that there's no validation of that, in the law or history, in the sense that there's no recognition of whether there's anything as the amalgamation treaty that brought Nigeria together. So I would like to get, your thoughts on this particular, contention that's ongoing.
Well, the 1940 amalgamation was merely a socio-economic and administrative convenience of the British. It's not a constitutional issue, it's not a legal issue. It is, in the face of the law, as far as I'm concerned, it is non-existent. I wrote a book the title of that book is that there is no Nigeria yet. Where I said Nigeria is an incomplete noun. And when used as an adjective, it qualifies nothing and identifies nobody. There is no Nigeria anywhere. So amalgamation, the treaty is even a much more, noble noble word for this, but there was no treaty. There was nothing like that. There was nowhere anybody, any group of Nigerians sat down to say that, okay, we want to be Nigerians. There was never any, there was no treaty, there was no meeting, there was no conference, there was no confab, where anybody, historically and constitutional and legally speaking, where anybody or group of people sat down that, to say that we want to be Nigerians. No. What happened, when we talk about the founding father of Nigeria, there are no Nigerians who are founding fathers of Nigeria. There are no Nigerians living or dead who are founding fathers of Nigeria. What we had were inheritors of Nigeria from the British. The British are the founding fathers of Nigeria. They are the ones that gave us the name. They are the ones that were ruling us through indirect rule. They are the ones who decided, okay, it is time to now amalgamate the northern and southern territories of Nigeria. So there were no Nigerians who ever sat down anywhere to say that we wanted to be Nigerian, even to be identified as Nigerians. It's not in history. You understand? So, and as you know, because I'm a historian, I studied history in the university. So the issue of you want to disunite Nigeria, then we were never even united so to speak. So, and I am saying that we accepted the amalgamation. We grew up to accept Nigeria as Nigeria because Nigeria was working. You know why? Because the parliamentary system that we inherited from the British was working for us because of the kind of diversity that we had, that we have as a country. So we had a parliamentary system of government whereby the Southwest was in its own, the Midwest was on its own, the North was not where it was. So we had this decentralized system of governance that allows each section of the country to make progress at its own pace within its capacity and the resources available to it. That was why we were able to have the kind of wonders and miracles that the Awolowos were able to perform. The first television in Africa, the first skyscraper in Africa, there are many things that are still surviving today that nobody has been able to replicate what Awolowo did in the Southwest. Nobody. Infrastructurally, academically, educationally, health-wise, in terms of agriculture, in terms of the economy, in terms of the politics, and in terms of the leadership. Nobody, no governor, has been able to replicate what he did. And I want to say the same thing for the Midwest, and the same thing for the North under Ahmadu Bello. So we have not been able. Immediately, the military came in under General Gbiyinrosi and killed the feudal system and brought in this unitary system. You know, that was when Nigeria began to go backwards. That was when Nigeria, every institution. Like universities, for instance, that belong to the Southwest, the university that belong to the North, like Ahmadu Bello University, the staff for the Southwest, Obafemi Awolowo University, and co. All the institutions that the federal government took over are now the worst for it now. We should have allowed that decentralized system to continue. If we had continued, I believe that Southwest, for instance, would have been the Dubai of Africa now. But where are we today? So the issue is that even if Nigeria were to continue, that's why we are asking for restructuring. Let us go back to the regional system that used to work for us. Let's go back to the regional system. If we don't want Nigeria to be dismembered, we have to restructure Nigeria. If we don't want Nigeria to rupture, we have to restructure it. You understand me? So that let's go back to the regional system that was working for Nigeria. This all-encompassing, all-powerful, almighty federal government sitting down in Abuja and dictating what happens at the local council level cannot work for Nigeria. Nigeria is too diverse to be imprisoned within the cocoon of a unitarized, repressive system that we are having at this moment. But it cannot work.
I mean, I'm just chipping. If we know the basics of, you know, a federal system is not that, unitarized, like you have mentioned, or all together, powers being separated amongst, you know, the three levels of government or what have you. So I don't know. I mean, some people have argued that federalism has always been the answer. So maybe we're not just practicing the federalism that we should practice. And that's why we're experiencing what we're experiencing.
The federalism that we have in Nigeria has been mismanaged. Okay, let me give you an instance. The governors, the state governors are being humored. They humor them, they call them the chief security officers of their state. But the governor, that same governor cannot give order to the commissioner of police. If for the governor to give order to the commissioner of police to do something, he will have to call the IGP. The IGP will now give order to this commissioner. The commissioner, under this current system, the commissioners of police are actually the chief security officers of the state. Because remember during the Abeshi, when Abeshi was governor of River State, the police blocked his way. The governor, a sitting governor of the state, they blocked his way. They said, you cannot pass through this place. They sent order from above. A sitting governor, and that's supposed to be the chief security officer of the state. And he was, the problem gave order for him to be shot. Now he got wiser and turned back. He said, a sitting governor in his own state could not pass through a place. They said, the police blocked the way. The CP said they should not allow him to pass, and he could not pass. If he had dared them, that they would have shot him. And it is the federal government that controlled the police. You know, so it is not a federal system. We are the governor of the state, the CP. You remember what happened to Chris Idige when he was governor of Anambra State? You know, the commissioner of police and the AIG, they moved to the state house and abducted a sitting governor in Anambra State, Chris Idige. You know, that is just in recent memory. So you call that federalism. This is not a federal. This is a unitarized federal system we are practicing in this country. The constitution is a lie. It is false. Decree 40 or decree 24 of 1999. So it's not even a constitution. It's a decree.
Right, Mr. Adebayo.
You know. So it's a decree. It's a military decree.
All right. Let's talk about.
So we don't have a true federalism. What we are having is just concocted. You know. False federalism. This is not federalism. This is a caricature of federalism.
All right, Mr. Adebayo, in your exchange, you talked about the need to restructure and all of that, because a whole lot of conversation has actually gone out concerning this topical issue, restructuring. To some people, restructuring means some devolution of powers. Restructuring means change of system of government. Restructuring also means resource control. And you also said that Nigeria worked better back in the day when we had a parliamentary system of government where each region also had a enough powers, you know, to handle some of their affairs. But then again, what is restructuring to you?
Restructuring to me is to restructure Nigeria for every zone of the country to have the powers and the authority to determine its fate.
Devolution of power.
It is not really devolution of power. I'm talking about a wholesome, total restructuring in terms of the fact that we don't want a devolution of power under a federal system. We want regional system, regionalism. If possibly even call a confederacy. Maybe you should just turn Nigeria to a confederacy. That would be restructuring for me. That would be restructuring for me. Because I don't want to have a situation where I'll be in a country where I will feel inferior to somebody else because the person in power believes that some people have the power to overpower and others. So let us go back to regionalism. I am for a restructured Nigeria. But where restructuring becomes difficult, then of course I will opt to go for Yoruba Nation. I will opt for Yoruba Nation. But for now, I am not for Yoruba Nation. I'm not for the dismemberment of the country. But where restructuring becomes difficult or impossible, some people make it so impossible, then of course, let everybody go their own way. I will not even talk about regionalism again. I will just talk about the fact that, okay, I want my Yoruba Nation. Let the Igbo get their Yoruba Nation. And of course, look at the coalition of Northern Nigerians, that they are now coming together, you know, say they are now beginning to sing the same song that the Southerners have been singing for long. They are now beginning to see the fact that Nigeria is becoming an albatross over everybody. They are now saying, okay, I think there will be peace. If for the sake of justice, let's renegotiate Nigeria. And please, this country can still work. I don't want you to misunderstand me. This country can still work. But what we need to do is to get the leadership right at the center. Let us get the leadership right at the center. Even under a federal arrangement, where you have good leadership, nobody will talk about destruction. Nobody's going to talk about dismemberment of the country. Nobody is going to talk about self-determination. If you have sterling leaders, if you have sterling quality leaders in the country at the center of power, if somebody who is able to manage our diversity in a way that our diversity becomes, you know, becomes an asset and not a problem to us. If you have a leader that is able to unite the people, a leader that is able to ensure progress, development, and justice in the country, you will see that everybody will go silent. Everybody will go silent. Nobody will be talking about self-determination or all these things. You know, some people were pushed to the wall, and the answer that they had no option again than probably to become violent, or probably to even begin to escalate their demand towards another civil war. Because of injustice. Wherever you have injustice, you can never have peace. Wherever you have injustice, you can never have progress. Where you have injustice, you can never have unity. So we should not talk. Unity should not come first. Our discussion should be talk about socio-political and economic justice in the land before we talk about unity and peace. That is it. So failure of leadership is what is leading to the failure of Nigeria as a corporate entity. Nigeria has never, from independence to date, has never been able to be blessed by a patriotic, committed, visionary leader. We have not been lucky to have one.
I'd like to take you on that now, Mark Adebayo, right? So you have actually mentioned that the system of governance that we operate now, even though in the books we say we're a federal government, we're a federal system, but in its sense, you have mentioned that we're practicing a unitary system of government where the power, where you have, you know, so much power in the center. But don't you think that, you know, it's not about the pattern of government or the type of government that we're practicing, or it's just about the people who are, you know, calling the shots and running the affairs? And you have also said that we have never had any leader that's what you're saying, that we've never been blessed to have some kind of good leadership. So I really don't know. You are advocating that we should go back to regional governance, and that might just take us away from all of this, you know, quest for self-determination. On the other hand, I'd like to, you know, share your thoughts on that. Now, I also want to find out if Nigeria is a signatory to the African Charter that allows Article 20 that allows for, you know, self-determination. Why haven't we? I mean, why are we very hesitant about that?
Well, you are very correct on your premise and your submission that you know, sort of confirming what I said earlier, that we have not been lucky to have
All right, I will try and reconnect with Mark Adebayo because we need to. Okay, I think we have him back. Hello, Mike. Mark, can you hear us? All right, we'll try and reconnect with Mark as we are about rounding off on this particular discourse. Mercy, there has been so much talk concerning the system of government, the issue of leadership, resource control, devolution of power, restructuring. A lot of people have different notions concerning that particular concept. You know, by the end of the day, the fact is that is that what we actually need? Mark, before we lost you, you were trying to answer to the question that Mercy raised.
To avoid one error, we should not think that immediately we go back to regionalism or we go back to, you know, the parliamentary system or whatever, or a restructured Nigeria. It doesn't mean that automatically it is rule. Every house has its own bad boy. Every family has its own black sheep. You understand? It's not going to be automatic. Whether if I have my Yoruba nation now, and if the same characters that are mismanaging and misruling Nigeria are now the ones to lead the Yoruba nation, it's going to be back to zero. So we have to get, if we are able to manage our diversity, if we are able to manage our leadership recruitment processes in a way that we produce the best among us to lead the country, Nigeria doesn't have to go. Because if each local government in Nigeria becomes a separate state, if it's becoming a deficit state, we may not experience progress if we are having the same crop of terrible human beings. Who are the, you know, we don't have political class in Nigeria. We don't have a political class. What we have is a political clique. We have political cliques who are parading themselves as a political class. You know, is it not a shame that after 60 years of independence, we cannot point out at one leader that we are to say that this is one at the national level, I mean, who has taken us from point A to point B in terms of progress, in terms of development. Or we have been having our looters and ethno-religious, bigots who divide us, who even exacerbate our diversity.
Okay, so let's get your thoughts on the fact that, I mean, because we're almost out of time, Nigeria is actually a signatory to the African Charter. Why are we being, you know, hesitant to allow for, because, I mean, in that it allows for self-determination. So why are we dragging foots and not allowing the people, you know, to decide whether or not they want to be together or go their separate ways?
Avoiding that action, that kind of action, is not a collective. It is not a collective responsibility of Nigerians. It is the responsibility, it is the fear of the people that benefit from the rot of the other development of Nigeria. Those who benefit from, they want a larger Nigeria where they can have more to loot. It is not a collective. Nigerians demand for that to actuate, to bring to life that charter of demand. But the powers that be, the political cliques, those who benefit from the rot, from the other development of Nigeria, are the ones who are running away from self-determination. The common people on the street will tell you that they want self-determination. Because, of course, this government has actually made it so look so difficult for Nigeria to continue as a corporate entity. It's a leadership problem, my sister. It's a leadership issue.
All right, thank you, Mark Adebayo. Indeed, we have been speaking about the state of Nigeria's politics, economy, and of course, what we need to do going forward. If we need to take that step and do a referendum and ensure that each individual gets to speak what they actually want, you know, as Nigerians. We have been speaking with Mark Adebayo. He's a public affairs analyst. Many thanks for sharing your thought and your input on this particular discourse. We do appreciate it.
Thank you for having me, Positively Africa. Thank you.
All right, thank you for joining us.
All right, in a moment, when we return from this quick break, we'll be focusing on crime, security. Customs intercept container laden with guns at Tinkan Island Port in a moment. And Dennis Makri, former assistant director of DSS, will be joining us to discuss more on that in a moment. Don't go away.